For the Lord's table, I'd like to consider the manner of Jesus' death. Jesus' death was the ultimate death, but it was also a most unique death because he laid down his life. His life was not taken from him. There was no external force that came upon him that caused him to die. There was no sickness, no accident, no old age, no violence that caused him to die. Although he was cruelly treated by men, you understand that's not what caused him to die. Jesus' death was truly a willing forfeiture of life. Prior to Jesus' death, there had been no death like this. So Jesus' death redefined the way that believers think about death and dying. The death that Jesus suffered, as opened up by the apostles, was a new kind of death that only Jesus and those who believe in him experience. It is the sacrifice of self and the intentional losing of life so that God can raise us up in newness of life. Mortals spend a great deal of time and effort and money trying to live longer and extend our lives and our health. But Jesus, who is the Prince of Life, set his face steadfastly to go to Jerusalem to accomplish his death. Unlike other men, he was sent to empty himself of his own life, and in his death he held nothing in reserve. This is what I would like for us to consider this morning, is that Jesus' death was a complete emptying of himself for God. When we stop to consider the spiritual record, it becomes obvious to us that Jesus was preparing for his death all of his life. When the time came for him to be offered up, he had no business to take care of. I'm not trying to be funny now when I say that Jesus didn't have any need to have a yard sale before he laid down his life. He owned nothing but the clothes he wore. By his own intentional manner of living, Jesus left this world with absolutely nothing. He had no home. By his own testimony, the Son of Man hath not where to lay his head. He had no wife, and therefore no children. He did not maintain any kind of profitable business. He had no means of income, but relied solely on the ministry of those who believed on him for supply. And when the time came for him to lay down his life, as he prayed in the garden, sweating as it were great drops of blood, his prayer was, "Not my will, but thine be done." He humbled himself by submitting to arrest and mock trial and cruel treatment by wicked men. And the last thing, the one thing that he had by necessity, his garments were taken from him and divided among the soldiers, that the scripture might be fulfilled, "They parted my garments among them, and upon my vesture they cast lots." So Jesus even died without his own clothes. Though he had earthly brothers and sisters, as he hung on the cross, he left the care for his mother Mary to the apostle John, as the good oldest son would do. Now Jesus spoke truthfully when he said, "The prince of this world cometh and hath nothing in me." There exists no more truly selfless and self-sacrificial life and death than that of Jesus. His was a true death, the complete emptying of everything of self and thorough ending of earthly life. Furthermore, the prophet Isaiah says, "He hath poured out his soul unto death." This manner of death was a necessity for Jesus for two reasons that I can see. One reason that Jesus completely emptied himself was so that he could be filled with our sins. Isaiah again describes the case so precisely, saying, "And the Lord hath laid on him the iniquities of us all." Peter says, "Who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed." And John says, "He is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world." He made atonement for sin by standing in the gap and absorbing the blow of God in his body on the tree. Now, Jesus emptied himself so that he could do this. All his hope, any profit that he might gain, lay ahead in what would happen after his death. He committed himself to the Father, knowing that only God could raise him up again and knowing that God would do it. God's promises to him were contingent upon his laying down his life, so nothing of value was taken to the grave. All that was born in his body was cursed. He shall see the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. Therefore will I divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he hath poured out his soul unto death. Now the second reason that Jesus emptied himself for death is because his death is the pattern for our death. Therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. For if we have been planted together with him in the likeness of his death, we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. For he that is dead is freed from sin. Now, if we be dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him, knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, dieth no more. Death hath no more dominion over him. For in that he died unto sin once, but in that he liveth unto God. Now that's the doctrine, and you see it actually fleshed out in Jesus' life and preparation for death and in his death, a complete total separation from the world. Peter says, who by him do believe in God that raised him up from the dead and gave him glory, that your faith and hope might be in God. The manner in which we are dead to the world and the world dead to us was then fleshed out in Jesus' death. Now, I'm not suggesting that we all quit our jobs and sell our homes and all that we have. That's not the manner of death that I'm speaking of. That's not the manner of death that God has called us to. I'm speaking here of something that God has done in you. If you were buried with Christ, God separated you from the world just as Jesus was separate. Yeah. He raised you up with Jesus to be aloof from the world, no longer dominated by it, and living unto God. And ye are complete in him, which is the head of all principality and power, in whom also ye are circumcised with the circumcision made without hands, in putting off the body of the sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ. Buried with him in baptism, wherein also ye are risen with him through the faith of the operation of God who hath raised him from the dead. What has God done for us in the circumcision of Christ? He has separated us from the world just as completely and thoroughly as Jesus is separated. This is something we could not do for ourselves. There is, though, an ongoing work for us to do. Let this mind be in you, which was in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men, and being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Mm-hmm. Wherefore God also hath highly exalted him, and given him a name which is above every name. As we follow Christ, eating his body and drinking his blood, and you know that's not a reference to the Lord's table. That's talking about you're living through him. You're eating him. You're surviving. You're living unto God through Jesus, what he has done. That is living off of him as he lived, fellowshipping with him in his sufferings, feeding on the will of God as he did. Then we also live with him by the power of God. Let's give thanks for this wonderful and powerful gospel in Christ. Amen.